Welcome to Designing Cities for All, another episode. And it's part of our 2-year-long activity and research program,
where we take a deep dive into designing products, spaces, and systems for all. Just because you feel safe, or you feel welcome, or you feel included, doesn't mean that everyone else around you feels the same way.
We don't stand alone. We're not individuals that somehow planet or an island, you know?
And I think that's the beautiful thing of a diverse society, that everyone can add something from out of their own experience.
Things won't change just if we just let things happen.
So I think if you can build relationships and use design as a tool to build those relationships, the better off we're all going to be.
Everything around us was once designed and can therefore be redesigned.
Belonging is a very, very important concept.
You can try to take someone's place for a while, but you don't have the lived experience.
Let's begin by acknowledging similarity and affinity.
Be a person, not your role.
I think inclusion is not a choice.
Inclusion happens by design or not at all.
In order to create truly inclusive public spaces that are accessible to everyone, we have to underline what everyone actually is.
Real inclusion, it's got nothing to do with the norm, but it's like something that we create from all different perspectives.
You know, so even when we bring everybody at the table, does everybody's voice count the same?
Because it's a big question of who tells these stories.
You know, the more I explore about other cultures, other religions, is the more ingredients I have to make the architecture and to answer the questions I get from society.
Not fitting in was a blessing, or I would have turned out just like you.
Hi everyone, welcome. My name is Shai Raviv. You just saw the wrap-up of the first year of Designing Cities for All. We are in the spring of the second year. This is a 2 years research and activity program by Pakastus Weicher, in which we take a deep dive into designing products, places, and systems for all. Tonight, we discuss participation, engagement, co-creation, involvement, and inclusion, words that we hear quite a lot around us in the context of design, business, or urban planning. And as we've seen in previous year, and also in this beautiful wrap-up, real inclusion happens by design or not at all. In this triptych, Together We Design, we explore the intention, the conflicts, the challenges, and the impact behind participatory design. And to make this night a bit more participatory, I'll be your moderator, but also a bit of a participant myself. I am the co-founder of the Voorkamer, a space where cultures meet in Utrecht, and the curator of the Embassy of Inclusive Society in the Dutch Design Week. And today we'll have a conversation with really interesting guest. We are continuing with the second part of Together We Design, Navigating Barriers and Conflict. And we will reflect these topics with Megan Ormond, Volker Treffers, Seitara Nourani, and Tobile Chittenden, who are joining us via the Zoom. We are not only welcoming the people here in the studio, but also you guys at home. So we would love to include both people here and at home at the conversation. If you're home and you have any questions, please go to Menti, menti.com, and insert the code 67451873, and then you can have a question posed and we can respond. And everyone here, please raise your hand and participate as much as you can. You will also be able to follow this program with live subtitles by clicking the link on our website. And in the note of barriers and conflict, I'm not usually a TV presenter, so I'm offering the space for making mistakes for me and my guests, for doubts and for not knowing. Our first guest is joining us through Zoom. I'd like to welcome Tobile Chittenden. She is the CEO of Makers Valley Partnership and director at the Change Collective Africa. Tobile, you are the CEO.
Hello, everyone.
You are the CEO of Makers Valley Partnership in Johannesburg, inner city. Can you please kick this night off by introducing the story behind Makers Place and what motivated you to be a part of that?
Sure. So yes, my name is Toby Lichtenden. I'm from Johannesburg, so I feel very far from all of you, but it's so awesome that we get to be connected virtually. So I also feel very different to the rest of the panel because I don't have any urban planning background or architectural background. I actually come from a history of marketing and advertising, and I've worked a lot with brands in my history. And I was always intrigued by the power and influence that brands have on society and the way that they can use their influence. And so part of my marketing and advertising journey was really looking at brands and working with them in youth spaces specifically, and really thinking about how can they make a meaningful difference in the lives of youth. And so I did a lot of different things. So working with big alcohol brands, for example, and curbing underage drinking in rural and township communities across South Africa, working with sanitary brands and teaching girls about puberty and reducing the lack of school attendance, because basically in South Africa, majority of the girls that are in their periods aren't able to access schooling because they don't have the actual needs that they require. And so there's various brands that I worked with across my journey in terms of really thinking, rethinking how they engage with their consumer and making sure that it's actually impactful. And it was during this time that a lot of the time it did feel a little bit like a tick boxing exercise, where you try so hard for this brand to be purposeful and really be socially minded. But it seemed like it was a bit of just, you know, ticking a box or showcasing themselves in a specific way. And this is when I got introduced to a concept called a well-being economy. And a well-being economy is really rethinking the economy to make sure that it is beneficial for people and planet, that it serves people and planet instead of people and planet serving an economy. And so during my understanding of this economy, I was introduced to a community that was really trying to work towards a well-being economy. And the founder, one of the founders, it was actually a movement of people in a community just outside of the CBD of Johannesburg that was really thinking about how do we enable ourselves. So instead of just waiting for government or waiting for a nonprofit to come and save the day, how do we use our expertise, our knowledge? We are assets, actually. And how do we use that as a basis in order to transform our community? And that's what we love. We love this enabling approach. And that's kind of what drew me to this community, is that it was actually about the change makers on the ground, the youth on the ground that wanted to make a change and say, hey, we are the experts of the social issues that we face on a daily basis, of the environmental issues that we face on a daily basis. And we have ideas that can transform our community. And so Makers Valley Partnership really centers around social and creative enterprise development as a tool to ignite change in our community. And it's a different way around to compared to a traditional nonprofit that says, we have got all these solutions for you. These are solutions that we're going to provide to your community. Actually, we flip that narrative, and the community has a space and tools and computers, access to Wi-Fi, etc. And we just enable them to grow their social enterprises, which creates ownership, which creates investment, which creates active participation. And we have seen through this kind of working, we call it asset-based community development, is that we can see a real transformation in our community because people feel like this is theirs. They have ownership. They really have solidarity and power over what's taking place in their community. Right. And instead of, sorry, am I going too much?
I mean, yes
you
and
can
no.
Stop me.
Well, we thought in order to bring us to you and you to us, we'll show a short video about the community and then continue with a few more questions. Is that okay?
Perfect. Sure.
Let's do that then.
You can go ahead.
Hi.
Basically, what we're doing as Makers Valley is we're looking at what synergies there are in the neighborhood already, what amazing stuff is already going on around making, and how we can create an identity in the neighborhood around making and creative placemaking. The route that we're looking at as a Makers Valley corridor of solutions goes from Ellis House, just behind Ellis Park here, down past the cricket fields, then past Boys and Girls Club South Africa. It joins up where the Yuksky daylights just over here.
This is the spot where the river daylights. We've got a very can-do approach to turn the people's gaze. They're looking away from the river at this point, to actually turn people's gaze towards the river. And in the process, we've got a network of specialists that is advising us how to do that.
I am Tumi Moreng. I am the director of the Makers Valley Collective. The Makers Valley Collective is a non-profit organization that is passionate about collaborating with makers who are already in the valley. These are the kinds of maker spaces that, you know, the entire community knows they can come and bring materials here, and we can all recycle and we all get into cleaning and being accountable for the spaces that we work in. I hope that Poppy is here. Poppy is a local maker, and so she's got a table where she sells locally made food. All the men that you see in these buildings that are fixing cars, they buy food from her.
I do magunya. I specialize in magunya, pap, beef, chicken, morocco, all this traditional food.
When we have network sessions and gatherings, Poppy is one of the people who actually make amagwinya for us at no cost whatsoever, because she would like to make a difference as well. And this is what we like celebrating, how we can work together and make things together.
Fantastic. In the video and also in the title of this initiative, the word makers of making is really central. And coming from the design background myself, I'm really curious how you relate the act or the practice or the process of making, being makers, to change making.
Yeah, so the history of this community is really this making spirit. What you saw there was a development which is now called Victoria Yards, but previously it was a car chop shop where people were fixing cars. There was woodworkers, steel workers, so a various range of artisans were predominant in that community. And I think what making and change making means, as I've alluded to before, is about taking ownership, taking care, taking stewardship. And I think those two things come together, is that you, when you do that, you see something come to fruition because of something that you've invested, because of something that you've molded or shaped. You get to see the fruits of that. And I think that's where making and change making really align. And I think it's why it's such an easy concept to grasp in our community, where it's so diverse. We have, it's a microcosm of Africa. Every single nation of Africa, with all the different languages, you'll find in our community. But just a term like making and change making comes so easily to everyone, and they grasp that concept because it's something that they've all naturally been doing their whole lives.
Right. Right. We'll dive a bit into ownership in the panel discussion. But just before we introduce our next speaker, I'm quite curious if you can share or elaborate on a specific project where there is a strong relationship between the community and the specific landscape of the valley. Also what we saw a bit in the video.
Yes, so, well, yes, the slides are showcasing at the background there. But one of the most recent things that we've just collaborated on with the community is just a park revitalization. There was a community park that was kind of the center of our community, but it was hijacked previously by drugs and just a whole range of social ills, if I could say that. And the kids didn't feel safe. They couldn't play there. Parents didn't feel safe there. And so it was an incredible process of transformation because it was a participatory process. People from the community get to decide what do they want to see in their park. And even the kids got to say, what do they want to see? What kind of activities do they want to be involved in? And although it was beautiful and there was a lot of co-creation with regards to this park, makers from our community were all involved in the various aspects that you can see in the pictures. But I must say that because of the diversity of our community, because of this history of the drugs and these gangsters that had ownership over it before, there was a lot of tension and a lot of learning, threatening messages in terms of who's going to take over. If so-and-so does the park, they're going to just break it down. We had an incident where the fence was torn down. So I must say that it's been a lot of lots of learning. And I think when the community stands together and we learned that we needed to get many people involved. So not just one supplier tackling the park, but we actually divided into 7 different suppliers to make sure that there was bigger buy-in from the community, which meant overall the ownership was broader and the few people that brought the issues to the party were actually silenced because there was so much more community buy-in.
Thank you for that. Yeah, we'll continue to touch a bit upon some of the challenges that you're mentioning here in our group discussion. But I'd like to welcome Volker Treffers, that is here in the studio, urban planner, architect, and project manager at 12 and Urban Matters. Hi, Volker.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thanks.
In 12 and Urban Matters, you specialize in what you define organic urban planning and resident participation. Can you give us a bit of an insight to what is organic urban planning and how do you view that practice?
Yeah, sure. What I try to do is when I'm designing, try to involve the people as much as possible, not because I couldn't make something beautiful only by myself. It will probably happen in a way, but because it becomes much, 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 much better when we do it together. Because there are so many different angles that you can look at a design. You can so many different angles that you can view and discuss and debate that all those small details that I would not take into account, the group will. And especially designing in a group is something that I really love to do. And not the fact that we are just all of us are having the pencil by our hand in our hands, but in somehow discussions, in debates, in talks, together with people who are really experienced in this area or really experienced in a specific topic that is included, or with people who are the craftsmanship. It's not only the residents in the future, but also the craftsmen. They really learn a lot to me. So in all these cases, I design together.
And do you relate that collectiveness into organic processes?
I think the possibility that you have participation design will become bigger when you have organic processes. Mm. And it is mainly got to do but that you have to get to learn to know each other a little bit more, that you have to speak the same language, that you have to try out a few things. And this grows organically. It's not necessarily needed, but it is making the chances or the opportunities bigger to result in something. The pictures that you see behind here, this didn't have that much to do with organic processes. Mm. This was just a social housing project with 400 houses. And in this case, my idea was, okay, why don't we ask to all the future tenants who were not there yet, actually, but why don't we ask them what they think is important for their future house? And this this was like a huge process to rebuild in a way, to organize everybody's decisions and processes in decisions and steps in the whole discussion also and design as well, because yeah, we wanted to have these people involved because we thought the design would become better and the involvement in the future living there would also become better.
And this is the Stripe S project you're talking about. Yeah. Can you introduce it a bit? What is Stripe S?
Stripe S is an area in Eindhoven in the south of the Netherlands, and it is a former industrial town. It's Philips Town, so technology. And in this main area that was decided to be transformed since 2002, there was this plot, what you see here right now, and it was empty, and the Social Housing Corporation asked me, can you think for us, what shall we design here? So I was actually asked as a designer, what kind of houses and how should it look like? They didn't know much except for the fact that they probably needed about 400 houses there. And I said, what I also did in renovation projects for the same Social Housing Corporation, well, let's just first ask those future tenants. But they were not there yet, so we started involving the people to come over to, if you want to live here, what is important for you then? And from this point of point zero, actually, we started, and all the decisions were made together. So they didn't design together with me, but they made the decisions as a co-owner of their future houses.
But this is really interesting. So they were not yet residents, and they could inform the design process. Was that somehow related to their ability to become residents?
Yeah. So as the more they were involved and the more ownership they took, the more chance they would have for a future house in this complex. And there were 400 houses altogether. There was about 1,000 people who were joining this process. And some of them, after 2 years, they found another place or they fell in love with somebody from Amsterdam. So they left town or whatever happened. And so these 400, I think all of them, they already, the first 300 people who joined and found their homes there, they had their first or their second best option to choose from in the final different houses that they could choose.
So everyone here, if you want a house, you should start participating.
Well, it was really, it really struck me that these kind of projects, they do exist on a smaller scale, and they do exist for people who have money and can buy their own house or can buy their own plot from the city. But it never actually happened with social housing. And the only thing which is different from social housing and non-social housing is the amount of money people have.
Of course.
It's not the amount of ideas they have for their own homes, or the quality of their ideas definitely was not less at all. Super. And it depends on how you define the process and how you get everybody in these meetings and these discussions. And it was like fun. It was like totally, it was a pleasure for everybody to join.
Yeah. And from the conversations we've had, we've learned that within this process, you also worked with a group of people on the autism spectrum. What did you experience was impactful, and did it in any way change the way you design such a process?
There were two special groups within the total group, and with three. But the students were like, let's say, the easy ones. They they will just raise their voice and they will come in. But there was two groups. One of them was the 30 people with autism spectrum, and they were having these very big difficulties in joining these processes. Like, we were with a group of like sometimes 50 or 75 people all together in one room, and it was just too much information for them. That's exactly their point. So we arranged separate meetings, and one or two who didn't have this ability of not being part of it, they were the spokesman in the bigger group. So there were somehow, we made a special addendum in a way on the process. And the other group was the group of kids, actually. They were 16 when they started joining. It was what we call a parents project for mentally disabled kids. So the parents initiated this group. There were in the beginning four, in the end it was 10 kids, 16 years old, and they were becoming like a co-housing group for mentally disabled. And they were with 10 because then the daycare and stuff like that can be organized really easily. And they were just joining all the time. they were there, and everybody was just like loving them, and they had their talks as well, and their meaning as well, and their specific or related ideas about living there as well.
Thank you. I have loads of follow-up questions, but now I will introduce our next speaker, and hopefully we can come back to that in our group discussion. Setari Nourani, who is joining us also online, not so far away, in Rotterdam, right? And architectural designer, researcher at Het Nieuwe Instituut. Welcome, Setari.
Thank you.
You're an architectural designer, currently a researcher at Het Nieuwe Instituut. What are the topics that you're exploring, and how do you navigate between your architect practice and your research practice at the moment?
Yeah, so I think that's a good starting question, because I actually wanted to open up with posing a general question of what is inclusion and participation for myself, or like how to co-design inclusion and participatory processes. And I think it's across all the projects that I'm involved in, whether in the Nieuwe Instituut or as an independent practitioner, I negotiate a lot in these different projects. And more explicitly, recently, I also negotiate what it means to enact remittance or enact redress across different communities. So yeah, I indeed wear many different hats, but there I like to refer to Brisson's notion of opacity. And I prepared like a little quote for those wanting to know what opacity is. He says, the right to opacity, that is not enclosure within the impenetrable autarky, but subsistence within the irreducible singularity. And in simple words, it means not being fully defined as so-and-so. And I really like not being fully defined as an institutional actor. And I'm also very much wary of people trying to single you out and define you as only an institutional actor or only an architect, for instance. And that's also something that I learned from working with Marina Otero, Vizier, and also Amal Al-Haj. In different situations, but also similar situations, being in and out of institutions. And I think then also we need to think of what does this institutional work consist of? Yeah. And yeah.
Is there a relationship between this notion of opacity and inclusion for you?
Yeah, I think so. Also like referring a bit to what Foucault said before, I find that inclusion processes also need to include space for those who do not want to be known as this or that. Also to include space for those who necessarily don't want to participate or want to participate in a different way. I think it's interesting to think of the term of neoliberal communitarianism in like the neoliberal situation that we're in, that we all have to fight for a right to citizenship, as also with other rights such as right to housing. And I very much believe that we shouldn't kind of prove our stake or our worth as citizens, because it should be a given that we have access to housing or have access to participatory processes, and not just depending on modes of accessibility or modes of ability, being able, financially able, being physically able to be present in these processes.
Yeah, thank you. What I relate to very well to what you're describing is the notion of opacity, is the idea that when you work on inclusion and participation, you have the tendency to try to get all the groups aligned, all your ducks aligned, and have sort of a list of groups. And then you inevitably fall into defining people as one group or the other. So yeah, sort of inviting opacity in that is quite an interesting thought. You're working at Nieuwe Instituut in a project called collecting otherwise, which also received the Museum Talent Prize for 21. Can you tell a bit more about this research?
Yeah, of course. So Collecting Otherwise is actually a collaborative project between different departments in the Nieuwe Institute, mainly the R&D department where I work and the Heritage department. And it weaves in current aims of the Nieuwe Institute to reassess its position in collecting and constructing heritage and asking fundamental questions around this heritage. And the project specifically proposes alternative methodologies to read the collection and to collect otherwise, to reflect on historical gaps and to acknowledge those that are typically placed outside of these historical legacies.
Yeah, and I feel like when I'm looking at this video that the notion of archival is being questioned here, also a topic that I think is really relevant when talking about institutional change and inclusion. Can you tell a bit more about your perspective on the archival?
So as a bit of a backstory or more information for those not familiar with the collection of the Nieuwe Instituut, it's the Dutch state collection for architecture and urban planning. And I just feel that it's very urgent to work with because it's one of the collections where ultimately also citizenship or Dutch citizenship is defined. Those who are made present or apparent in our public realm throughout the decades. And the archival is both a sense of curation. It's those who are made apparent in the collection or have been silenced. The archival is also deciding over life and death or what gets to have an afterlife in different narratives, what is remembered in our community. The archival is also that which resides in all of us, because I also very much believe that we contain multitudes. We contain many different stories that are worth being remembered. So the archival is also that which sits in between us.
So I have exactly enough time to squeeze another question. You also worked on an exhibition in the Amsterdam Museum, Koloniale Verhalen, Work in Progress, Colonial Stories, Work in Progress, which was about decolonization. Can you tell a bit more about that, but specifically about your relationship between the curator, the spatial designer, and the other exhibiting designers or artists?
Yeah. So in this project, I was the spatial designer. And again, with these many different hats, it also brings as an advantage that you have a better intuition for that which the curators are looking for, because you're also into their research topic or into their topic of the exhibition. And I started, as I usually start within design processes, really in conversation, thinking, trying to bring out what they really want to see and what narrative they want to tell to a broader audience. And then I respond with a written statement, just so you know, like, because they post questions and then I post questions back. It's all about this negotiation again and seeking that space for reflection, and sometimes can cause discomfort, because what is now actually, what is the role of a spatial designer in these very like temporary processes of exhibitions and biennales? I believe that we also should be there to ask questions.
Thank you. And we have another guest here that is also probably quite good in asking questions. Megan Ormond, you're associate professor in cultural geography at the Wageningen University and a researcher and educator at the Migrant Tour Project. You also wear many hats. Can you tell a bit about Migrant Tour Initiative and what is the core principles of it?
Sure. So Migrant Tour is an initiative that began in 2010 in Turin, in Italy. It is basically, the concept are two-hour guided walking tours that are led by people with refugee or migration backgrounds. Right now, the initiative is covering more than 20 cities throughout Europe, and now it's also extending into rural areas. My own involvement in this initiative began in 2019 when I was invited to come to a conference as part of the broader project, and got very, very excited about the potential of this initiative. And so in the last couple of years, we managed to get some funding and have been able to start to begin to put together a migrant tour in Utrecht, in the neighborhood of Lombok.
So we are cheating here a bit because I am the co-founder of the Four Kamer, where Migrant Tour is now doing its Dutch, Dutch version. Also building on Setari's multiplicity. Can you tell a bit about what you're doing at the Four Kamer and how you incorporate participatory methods?
Sure. So the purpose of these migrant tour guided walking tours is to give a kind of an alternative narrative of the places in which we live, and to support people with refugee and migration backgrounds to see themselves as locals who have the authority to speak about the places in which they live, and to not merely represent peoples and cultures that may be connected to their ancestors or the places in which they may have grown up. So to really see them as active citizens who have a voice. And so what we've been trying to do within the case of Utrecht, of course, is to bring this initiative to fruition in the Netherlands for the first time. So we have a group of 15 people that we are currently working to co-create the guided walking tour. The intention here is not to already have a kind of a potted plan for what the tour will look like, but to really build on the experiences, the personal journeys of those who are participating in the project as intercultural companions or as guides, to build on their stories, their perceptions of the places in which they live, the things that they care about, and to co-create, to co-curate the guided walking tour route, and to think about the kinds of stories that they wish to tell about the different places that we would encounter on the tour.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure you guys also had it, but when you have a guest and you're showing them around in your city, you start feeling much more at home, even if it's not your hometown or your birth town. And I think that's quite interesting in this case of the Four Kamer, that we try to question belonging and to construct belonging. And through giving a tour to someone else based on the place, but also the self, mm-hmm. you really start sort of finding different interpretations for belongings. So you are only academic practicing guest here tonight. And I know that you've put so much work and energy and sweat into this initiative. And I'm kind of curious, how do you sort of navigate between being a researcher, academic researcher, and then pushing such initiatives in practice or outside academia wall?
Yeah, thanks for that. It's a real challenge. The academic system is not something that really privileges long-term investment in a place or with an organization, with a group. Oftentimes it supports more extractive sort of scholarship in which you get the data and then you get out and you analyze it from a distance. And so to participate in a project in which you are really not trying to stand from outside and look upon others, to actually work together, to co-create, to learn together, is a process that has required a lot of unlearning from my side. As a scholar, I've been trained to behave in particular ways, to do research in particular ways, and so in these last years, as I've opted to take a more transformative and participatory approach in the research that I do, I've had to learn how to step back. And question my own positionality, of course, but to also um, work with others to move beyond the limitations of academic language, to break down some of the barriers that exist, to create real trust, and to also demonstrate that that I'm in there for the long run. I'm not there to just take and to go.
And this is kind of my interpretation, but please challenge that. I feel like the Migrant Tour initiative has objective that it wants to achieve, sense of belonging, and bring people into their own city, and sharing those stories. And that's the main objective of this initiative. And then the academic research comes on top of that, rather than perhaps in a reserved, more traditional process where you have objectives to conduct academic research and you create a project around that. Is this correct positioning?
Yeah, it's just messy. It's a messy organic process, and one that's also very joyful, but also very frustrating. But one that requires very different kinds of skills. It requires skills of communication, of being open to outcome, where you're not quite sure what kind of data you might co-generate. What you are certain of is that you are engaging in particular kinds of processes that are valuable to those with whom you're working, and also outcomes that are valuable for those with whom you're working, not just producing papers that are read by a handful of people.
What do your colleagues think about it?
They celebrate it. I'm very lucky to be surrounded by people who really appreciate the kind of work I'm doing, and yet at the same time, that kind of work is not appreciated within the system in which I work.
Because it's actually a lot of volunteer work, if we put it on the table.
At the end of the day, it's a lot of volunteer work. It's a lot of activism. And so that's, it doesn't fit within the box, and it's not rewarded in the ways other kinds of scholarship are rewarded.
If we have in between questions here, actually I think I have a minute for a question from our public here. Anyone with anything? Yeah.
How do you position yourself as a researcher? Because
Sorry, just a second. A microphone is coming from the beginning.
How do you pose yourself as a researcher in this project? For example, anthropologisch research, then you really participate. Is that also the case here, or are you more like in a double role, both as a researcher and a participant? Like, how do you?
Great question. Thank you.
I think you can think about it in terms of almost an ethnography. You're fully engaged, and you're not just observing; you are also making. And I think that's the challenge, is that there's not there are not a lot of maybe role models out there to really help you think about how do you actually navigate these sorts of challenges. And so I think it's a question of figuring out, what are kind of the broader conceptual issues that I'd like to engage with? And I'm going to talk with lots of people and work on these things together. We're going to make, and through making, then we will be able to develop further thought on these sorts of questions. It's a different process. And it takes a lot of humility to realize that you don't have all the answers, and that you need to turn to others and really listen.
Thank you.
Well,
a quick small reminder to those who are watching at home, if you want to pose a question, use the Menti website, menti.com, with the code 67451873. This feels really funny to say this. Kind of fun. And now we are at the fun part of this evening, where we bring everyone together to a table talk, but we all stay where we're sitting. So with Tobile, Folco, Setari, and Megan, thank you for your generous stories and introductions. So far, we spoke quite a lot about sort of more the positive or the enjoyment of participation and inclusion or participatory design. But tonight is about barriers. So I'm wondering, and maybe it's good to go back to you, Tobile, from the beginning. You already touched a bit upon some of the challenges that came about in the park process. Could you tell us a bit about how you dealt with some of the dilemmas or maybe the tensions between the different participants of the park project?
Yeah, sure. So I think, as just mentioned, is that we don't have all the answers. And so when you start to get threatening messages about whatever you build is going to be broken down, it was actually a solution that came from a community member themselves that said, let's split the work amongst many people in the community. Our community, especially at that time, was hard ridden by COVID. Many of the people in our community were not working at all. We have huge unemployment rates in South Africa. And so the possibility or the opportunity to have some work was really, really accepted and welcomed at that stage. And so avoiding like having the government or the city come and say, this is the person that's going to be working on this park. Actually, we diverted that and said, actually, can you make sure that the people that are working on this are from this community? One. Two, that we actually make sure that every single person that provides a tender or request for work is vetted and checked beforehand, because this is where the criminality comes in, is that a lot of these so-called providers are actually undercover crooks, if I can put it bluntly. But what was beautiful to see is that the community knows them, the community sees them. And because we made it broad, as I mentioned earlier, that we allowed many participants to work on this park, there was so much solidarity amongst the various people that came together. They were the watchmen. They became voluntary patrollers at night to make sure that these criminals were not, embarking on the park or doing anything destructive. What was beautiful to see is that they also purchased walkie-talkies, for example, because we don't have much access to data or Wi-Fi in these types of communities. So walkie-talkies were distributed amongst the community to make sure that everyone was on watch to stand by to ensure that our park wasn't demolished. I just thought it was beautiful to see that as much as we opened it up, that the community then took ownership and made sure that they protected the park themselves, and just in an organic way made sure that they were keeping each other in the loop in terms of what was happening.
Yeah.
So I think that was just the solution, is that it came from a community member themselves coming up with an idea and strategy.
And I have a follow-up and perhaps a bit triggering or a bit challenging question. I don't know the context well enough, but I am wondering, when you talk about criminals or people that used the park before, are there not some of them that are also a part of the community? Or have the community not expressed sort of needs to deal with that in a different way? Relationship between criminality and ownership of space and access to money and so on. Were there also discussions about sort of that tension?
So there are many tensions, and xenophobia is one of the tensions that we face in our community. But in this case, it wasn't a xenophobic issue. It was actually, that's why I'm saying the solidarity came up through and through, because so many different people of different cultures, of different religions, were standing by against the criminal activity. And it's interesting that the criminals, which is why there was such a strong vetting process, were not actually from the community. They have various paperwork to try showcase that they are. But the community knows, they've lived there for many years, and this is all generations. So from the kids, who are amazing just in terms of knowing what's happening in the community, they were very, very strong and vocal in terms of what they're seeing in the park. And so the criminal activity was very much an outside group and operating in various inner city societies, specifically through drugs. So it's more of a drug issue, the criminal activity, not really an inside community issue. Right.
Thank you for that. So yeah, I'd like to kind of open up this question to all of you. Can you unpack a barrier or a dilemma that you encounter often with the idea of participatory design or the practice of participatory design? Falco?
Yeah, I think I've got two, actually. One of them was slightly mentioned by Megan about unlearning. Mm. And I think to really design in a participational way, we should try to let go as much as we can. It counts for us, but it also counts for the people who are participating, which is quite interesting. That they could not sometimes understand that we were asking questions, that we are asking questions. How do you feel about the budget for rent as you wanted? For example, I mean, we even ask questions like that. How do you feel about who could be your neighbor in the future? And it's the kind of question that was very important for them, actually, but it was they couldn't understand that it was even part of their ownership in a way, because it's part of the project. So to try to get rid of all those things that you think which are normal is one of the challenges I think is so important, and it starts with the people who initially have the money, and then we have to, but that's only the first step. So this is something that I'd like to be more and more trained in, how to get everything, to get everything loose, free from the way we used to do it, the way we learned to do it, because those ways are very often, they're just a way. And then the second thing I'm challenged with at the moment is in many projects, we want to involve as many other people as we can, but this connects to the first one. When you have, for example, a group of disabled people who are talking about a square, when it's just a group of disabled people who live around the square, they tell everything they know. But when it's a group of officially spokesmen of a group of disabled people, they're in a way professionals as well. Mm. You hear much less. It's crazy. They are the professionals in their topic, but you hear actually less because they are doing this every day. They don't even they don't see all the details of this specific location anymore. They just do their speech as they're done so often. And this is with disabled people. But for example, now in Utrecht, I'm doing a huge project about inclusive cultural public space. Cultural buildings and public space, and inclusiveness in religion and skin color and background, newcomers, and all of them, they are very much they have a very big difficulty in rethinking their own position, and so do I. And this is one of the main challenges now, to have everybody on the table in the right spot, in the right way, in a total freedom, as equal as possible, but then in the speed that it's fun and it's coherent, it's going on, you make progress, and this is it takes too much time to unlearn.
Yeah. Actually, I want to build on what you're saying within the process of design research or participatory research. And here I have kind of the duality of two roles. At the forecamera is a space where people come to be themselves, a safe space to meet new people. We get about weekly email requests to do research. And we get a question, hey, I'm doing a research about mothers from my migrant background. Can you bring up a group of mothers so I can talk to? The week after, it's about working or distance to the job market. The week after, it's about access to health. And as a researcher, I know how important it is. And I know that a place like the forecamera could be an access to a community and voices that are not heard. As a community member or community organizer, I find it so tiring, because people don't come to the forecamera as research subjects. They come to be themselves. And once that place becomes a research laboratory, it is no longer a safe space. And I'm kind of in this duality, because I take on often one or the other position. And I'm curious if any of you, also Satari, Tobila Online, have experienced these dilemmas.
Normally, I just ask to the people who are involved if they want to join.
Yeah.
don't decide it as a coordinator or a professional or whatever. I mean, just let them decide. That's, if they are there, then it's up to them if they feel like it.
Yeah. So Tari, or screen is green.
Yeah. Perhaps also drawing from experiences in other projects, like social arts projects that I've been involved in, and connecting to what Megan said before, it's all about ethical engagement as well as a researcher or as someone deciding to engage with a specific community and being transparent about a lot of things. So transparent about your timeline, like for what period are you actually there? How much are you planning to be involved? So they also are aware of your limit as a body doing this work. At the same time, them not feeling as if they're indeed a research subject or a guinea pig, but that you're there to listen to their stories, value them, and also giving them an idea of how the work is being used. So then, like, being in touch actually for a longer period, informing them of the inception of the project, the different stakeholders, how their information may be used, and then afterwards being in touch about the end result, inviting them. Like, that's something that I hear actually from, for instance, people that I have come across in De Bijlmer or in Horen, or even engaging with women architects who have been interviewed a lot of times, but then, for instance, like, the end results of the interviews are not communicated to them, not shared. It's a process that you really have to think of. Okay, yeah, I'm engaging with them, but it's not only one point in time. You have to be aware of the entire timeline of information and taking away assumptions as well. And it's something that I try to practice in many different projects, and also in institutional projects like collecting otherwise.
Yeah. Tobila, do you want to add?
Yeah, I love, I really resonate with this, because we do have a lot of participatory fatigue in our community. And I think everything that's been said is so relevant. But to add, just bearing in mind, what is the condition of this person? Where are they at as a human being right now? And how will your questions obviously impact that? But it's so tiring to be asked about specific research questions when you might not even have food to eat, or you haven't had electricity for a week. And so it's very difficult to engage enthusiastically, especially repeatedly over time with various researchers coming in. So I think for me, one of the biggest things is actually just bearing in mind who this human is, what are their challenges that they're experiencing, and how can we be mindful in our approach in terms of that research?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, what I found quite interesting, and I think that relates in a way to the idea of migrant tour as a body of knowledge, is that, for instance, someone approached us at the forecourt and said, I want to do a research about motherhood. We said, yeah, that sounds great, but why don't you join our women activity and become an active member of the community? And why don't you, or how could you find a way to organize your research in a way that it feeds into the ongoing activity rather than making like a form of questions? And she ended up doing a lino print, that's like a hand carving print session around motherhood. And it was, this is just really nice because it's sort of weaving in different perspectives. Megan?
Yes.
In migrant tour, people are creating tours also as an economic solution, but there is an economic trigger to
component
it.
Component
to it. Has there been dilemmas or conflicts around that?
So migrant tour as an initiative is one that covers so many different cities throughout Europe, and of course we can't speak about Europe as being a homogenous space
that
at all.
We can't.
And so we're talking about countries like Italy, Portugal, Spain, but we're also talking now of the Netherlands, Belgium, France, where economic systems and social welfare systems are extraordinarily different from one from the other. So with that in mind, the Migrant Tour Initiative has from the start always sought to provide some economic support, payment, in compensation for the guiding services that are provided. And always done in a way that is ethically appropriate to the wage levels of commensurate with guiding fees in other countries, in different countries. So that's always been something that has been at the core of Migrant Tour, because it's a responsible tourism initiative that seeks not only social sustainability, but also economic sustainability. And one of the interests also of the initiative is not just to pay people for their guiding services, but also ultimately to eventually create a space in which the guides themselves can create a kind of a co-op and work together and turn it into something that can sustain them more fully. But it's not a full-time job.
No.
It's a part-time thing that most people do in addition to their studies or other kinds of work. And they do it out of love. They do it out of passion. And they do it out of a form of activism, first and foremost.
Yeah, thank you for that. So the topic of continuity or ongoing engagement or follow-up has been mentioned by, I think, all of you. And I was quite curious, for example, despite the Stripe S project that Volker, you were describing, is already standing. The building is already there, right? Is there a follow-up or post-project practice that ensures the ongoing ownership or participation once the building is there and your job is over then?
Well, within the community itself, they kept all the targets, and the community just continues on organizing this themselves. And I was there a year ago. It was realized, I think, 2016 already. So I was there 1.5 years ago, and they told me what had happened in the 3-4 years in between. And I think there were about 20 targets that they wanted to achieve when they started living there, actually, so 3-4 years before that. I think 19 out of 20 that have been succeeded or still enrolling, and it was still happening. And they missed only two, and they made two new targets next to that. So in this case, yeah, it was like a continuous process. To start new projects like this became actually much more difficult. Still, even though the project is there, it won many prizes. The data are outstanding. I mean, you can just now, after 5-6 years, you can just count how much money you earn by that as a social housing corporation, for instance, by having this kind of a process done. And still, all of those organizations are afraid to really let go. That is, in the end, to really trust, to really let go the responsibility and give it to the tenants or the future tenants, and this is like a very, very difficult discussion still.
Because this is something I've always been very sort of pondering in my mind, and especially when we talk about architecture and co-design. When you invite people into the process to make decisions with you as an architect or a designer, in a way you also share the responsibility for the space and you create ownership. But what happens if something goes wrong? Is there also a shared accountability?
It's not sharing in the case that it becomes, in total, it could be something in between and becomes less. No, it becomes on top of each other. So what happens actually is you as an architect, or you're as a construction engineer, or you're as a physical engineer, you're a part of this process. And you get questions asked by your future residents. And they ask about how much music can I actually make, for example, in my house? Because I'm a musician, I play the piano, I don't want my neighbors to be disturbed when I'm going to live there. And they say, is this so many decibels? And they say, what is a decibel? I don't know. Okay, we're just going to test it. So then we just started to make these real-life test locations in other buildings, or we went to the road and said, okay, the road is now making so much noise. this is your noise. What is actually happening? So all those things that we just started testing, skill one-on-one with blocks, skill in existing buildings that were already owned by the social housing corporation with the same technology, and they said, okay, let's just do it. And then from there on, it was the starting point of the discussion. Those engineers, they said, I've never had actually the possibility to really discuss how much 90 decibel actually is. This is the first time I really heard it, because those people, they just asked me. So the qualities topped on to each other. And what happens is that next to that, when the discussion is about something that maybe it sounds a little bit unrealistic, as a facilitator, which I am, or as a head of design, which somebody else was in that case, you have to let the process do its role. So when you have like 25 people in a room and one of them says, oh, really, we're going to have the swimming pool on top of the roof. And in the beginning, every meeting, there was somebody was yelling this. And the only thing that you needed to do was do nothing. Because if you're responding like, well, a swimming pool is going to be really, really expensive, then it's suddenly me against them. When I didn't do anything, then the guy in the corner started saying, Foco, if we have a swimming pool on the roof, who's going to pay for this then? Is it going to be part of my rent? Is my rent getting higher when there's a swimming pool on the roof? And then I say, well, in general, why should you have a swimming pool on your roof and the other social houses should not have a swimming pool on the roof? Maybe, yeah, it's logical that you have to pay that for that. But if you really want it, it can. And then suddenly the swimming pool just was gone out of the room. And it was this kind of discussion techniques that you really have to do understand as a facilitator. And then you're really adding up all those qualities.
Yeah.
Because then suddenly somebody knows something about swimming pools or something about, not the swimming pool was not important, but about trees. And somebody knows something about bees and about ecology. And somebody else knows something about how to organize group meetings in a more special way with more fun, or they know about a project that you want to visit with the whole group, and then suddenly everybody comes in and you add all those qualities, because I'm just alone. What else can you be doing? How else can you organize a team of 200, 250 people who were starting to work on this project? It was brilliant.
Yeah. So it sounds like we all have to become politicians to engage in participation, where you have to kind of negotiate and navigate between the different needs of the groups.
I don't know if that's politics, but at least we have, as a designer in buildings with a collective meaning, whether it's a public space or it's social housing or it's like a community building or a cultural space. When your designer is in that kind of a place, you have to facilitate all those different backgrounds, facilitate all those different angles of meanings of whatever, those visions. If you think that only one vision is your vision, it's true, well, I'm not in.
Yeah. Setira and Tobile, if you've had experiences where you felt like the stories of the community were being extracted or used within a project and then sort of left behind. If you've had painful moments where stories floated above but were not really used as a layer, as Volko described.
Perhaps, Tobile, you can answer, because I actually wanted to go into the negotiation or where Foucault left behind.
So go ahead, go into negotiation.
Yeah, of all right, course. Yeah, because
we're improvising.
I brought like a short poem, and it's part of the anthology called The Bridge Called My Back. And it's one of the books that awakened feminist consciousness in Liedewij Timmers. And Liedewij Timmers is one of the former members of Vrouw Bouw Wonen, whose archives we have recently acquired as a Nieuwe Instituut, and also as a co-conspirator in thinking along with our archive. But this book is just absolutely amazing. And this poem I found so striking. And it's titled The Bridge Poem by Donna Kate Rushin. And it starts, I've had enough. I'm sick of seeing and touching both sides of things, sick of being the damn bridge for everybody. Nobody can talk to anybody without me, right? I explained my mother to my father to my little sister to my brother to the white feminists to the black church folks, the black church folks to the ex-hippies to the black separatists to the artists to my friends' parents. And then I've got to explain myself to everybody. I do more translating than the goddamn UN. And I find this really striking because this translation work and this being the bridge is something that weaves in the work that we're all describing, in the research work, in the work as an architect. And then I'm thinking, if you don't want to do the translating work anymore, if you don't want to fulfill this bridge position, what is then left? If you have this exhaustion of trying to explain yourself and your community to others, what is then left? And how can we also negotiate this conflict and this exhaustion?
Thank you. That was beautiful. We have about a minute before we open up questions to the audience.
Can I ask, Satera,
sure.
It was not totally clear for me whether you do or do not want to be the bridge.
That's the question. Yeah, you know, like from my own perspective, I was always voluntarily, but also involuntarily, the bridge as a child, but now also as a professional mm-hmm. practitioner. So it has been like ingrained in how I work. But then is being the bridge, is that a comfortable position? And I think also this like institutional work, this labor of the bridge needs to be acknowledged and needs to be compensated and needs to be alleviated, and exactly by collective work, acting as a collective, I think it can be alleviated.
Tobile, could you maybe elaborate a bit about the act of translation within your community? Is this a practice you recognize? Are you the bridge?
I definitely think, yeah, I relate so much to what you're saying. I definitely feel the tensions of being the bridge. But I've also learned in the last couple of months that actually allowing other people to take on that role, and it doesn't look the same as the way that I would approach it. That's been interesting for me, is to see how different people will translate things just because of the lens that they have on. And sometimes it's actually freeing, even though it's not the way that I would have connected or translated. It's actually freeing to see it taken over by a different group or by a different perspective, and seeing that unravel on its own. And I liked what Fulke was saying, is that, you know, sometimes we want to see longevity, and we already, because of the lens that we have on and we've been conditioned in our upbringing, we have a specific translation already formed, and you're trying to kind of just articulate it in the best way possible. But what's been surprising for me and the learning journey is that, sure, some of my translations have been completely different, but sometimes still can get to the same outcome, even though it's a different journey. So it sounds really philosophical.
And sometimes even to a different outcome, and which you learn from yourself as well.
Exactly.
So being a bridge is, I think, it's a brilliant position, but you still have the opportunity on to which part of the river that you really want to mm-hmm. turn to. I mean, you don't have to connect the roads. You can connect different parts of this both sides of the river. So it's, when you're a bridge and when you at least have this ability to be the bridge, it sounds like a perfect place. Mm. And you can always say, well, not always.
If I may, I think it's not just a question about yourself being a bridge, because I think it presumes then that others are solid entities. And I think the challenge becomes when you start to see others as bridges as well. Mm. And so this kind of intersections and linkages between multiple bridges, right? I think it comes back to that beautiful notion of opacity that you raised at the beginning of the session today, right? Not being fully defined. And I think if we were to think about ourselves as many bridges in the making, constantly reaching out to one another, what would happen then, right?
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, I 100% align with this, but again, like bringing up a friction in institutional work or even in politics, in identity politics, is that now more and more you still see people being singled out as advocate for a community, as the face of. And that completely negates the collective work that actually has been done for this particular project or community or within the research. And similar to me, like, I have to give a shout out to everyone involved in collecting otherwise, because without their work, I wasn't able even to think, you know, like, beyond my own particular set of intersections on what archiving actually means for people in different geographies, for instance, in the Philippines or Indonesia. It really has strengthened the research that we were doing in being able to work with a very diverse working group, and that counts for every project that I've been doing, that I always feel very uncomfortable if a single person, you know, like, gets acclaimed for X or Y or gets invited. Mm.
So
could I speak to that just for a moment, or do you need to?
Maybe it will come with this little translation and extraction question I have for you all. I was wondering if each one of you four dear participants and guests want to give one takeaway that you are taking with you from this conversation, and then we'll do a few questions from the audience. So perhaps Megan, you could start.
I wanted to reflect a little bit further on what you had said there. And I just thinking about the migrantor experience so far, you know, coming back to this question you had about the unpacking a barrier or a dilemma. And I think it is that question very much about recognizing yourself as a bridge or as being something constantly in the making. You know, I'm working with people, all of us, you know, when we're asked to represent ourselves or represent something, we turn to these potted stories oftentimes about and turning to different kinds of identity politics and not allowing ourselves to unpack the diversity that's within us. And so I think that's the barrier oftentimes, and in the work that I find myself doing is supporting people in seeing that the value that they bring in terms of the stories that they'd like to tell about the world, it goes so much beyond certain kinds of potted identity politics, that it comes from recognizing extraordinary complexity. And so helping people go through processes to tap into that recognition of that complexity is a barrier, and it's also the greatest source of beauty.
Yeah, rather than sort of trying to remove it to get sort of a clear one narrative.
Yeah.
Thank you. Would you care to give us sort of a takeaway, Thobile, something that lingered with you in the past hour and a half or so?
Yeah, sure. I loved what Megan just shared. I think, sure. I think we are living in such a complex world and every community is different. But I've loved kind of our local approach because we can kind of really dig deep into the complexities that this local community is facing. And something that I don't know why I feel like I have to share is that not everything is sustainable. Not everything has longevity, and that's fine. What I've loved about things is that, you know, lots of concepts and ideas and innovations have evolved and there has been sustainability, but some things have just been perfect for such a time, such a specific period, and then they fall away because they're no longer relevant. And COVID threw a lot of those dynamics in. And, you know, you might think, oh, it wasn't successful because it's not remaining right now, but actually it was super successful for that specific period and that context and those dynamics of the community. And so, yeah, I just wanted to leave with that. Just allow things, if it does need to continue, it will evolve because there's community buy-in and there's obviously a need for it. Absolutely. But sometimes it's actually fine for things to be let go of.
Absolutely. Volker, a thought, a takeaway? Can be random, can be
random,
translational.
Just a random, random thought.
Can be intuitive, something that pops up.
No, the discussion is too worthwhile for me to just leave it with a random thought. I started looking at my notes and I saw all those uncertain words in a way. So it's constantly in the making, not really being fully defined, the unlearning, everything has to be, all those things has to be changed, to be transformed, to get used to new. I mean, this is what my notes are now. And this is interesting. I just have a thought without a... So why is it so complex? Why is it so... If I look at this, it's actually quite simple. Because, well, we can just try. And there's so many things that need to be changed. It's quite it feels uncertain in one way, but in the other way, everything we discussed today was about uncertainty and not knowing it for all. So we can just try and we can just do the best we can. But somehow it feels as if we have really a lot of work to do to make this happen. And I don't know what it is, but this is what I will start thinking about tonight. To how to look at this differently, that I don't see it as a complex thing, but as an easy thing. Maybe it would help me. Maybe not. I don't know.
No, convince the municipality, say, hey, give me this project. I'm not certain what will come out of it, but let's go.
I don't know if it's about work. I mean, it's also about just normal relationships, talks. I mean, it is. I mean, there's so many different angles to how to look at it. There's so many different ways, and if we call it very complex, and we already start making it complex right away, then people are starting to be scared of it, maybe even. And when I say, okay, we don't know it either. But we can just give it a go and let's try and let's meet and let's talk. And then I don't know, it was just a thought. I mean, I didn't think about it that long. But
no, I love it. Sitari, maybe a last note as a dessert?
I was thinking about how we're also speaking about meeting ourselves in the midst of life. In the thick of life, or in the thick of things, and in this making or unmaking process, I think I want to end with that the bridge is always under construction.
Hell yeah. I think I have a minute. I see everyone is there. Finish. A minute to offer someone from here to pose a question. Yeah, microphone is coming your way.
This is a question to no one in particular, because I think you all actually touched on it with regard to unlearning. And even though participatory processes in design and in other aspects of like an inclusive society have really been like moving the needle away from extractive processes or exploitative processes, I wondered... also with what Sitari brought up about decolonization, which I think is so key to all of these processes is just decolonizing the way we think about it, and how so much friction comes from that unlearning. And I wanted to know if any of you had any like particularly key experiences about the difficulty in unlearning and the barriers that you came into, or any thoughts on that?
Megan, Safari?
Safari.
I actually have many. Yeah, I don't know. but to bring in a couple of things, I think decolonization just goes at the heart of so many processes that we are in institutions, but also as designers, you know, like from the two-dimensional signification elements that we use, such as maps or drawing floor plans, and how to rethink that, grid systems to process systems like scoring sheets, or making your project like smart or whatever, like outcome-based approaches, which also need to be decolonized, since outcome is about performance, and performance is also about ability, and it's about inclusion and exclusion. And I think at the heart of you know, like projects that claim to decolonize design, I always wonder whether they have decolonized their budget, have thought about remittance, have thought about other ways of enacting redress. And again, this is a process of continuous learning and unlearning, since, from the beginning of education or professional engagement, you're already instilled with particular ways of doing that you then have to unmake and relate back to an alternate future.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that was a great answer to your question. So we are coming to an end of a really fun evening, and super dynamic. Sticking to the bridge, I think there is sort of a feeling of two-sided from some of the things that were mentioned, a feeling of supposedly two sides of an X or a contrast of learning and unlearning, long-term investment, or when does something end? And I'd like to sort of take that bridge and say, yeah, it's not per se that or the other, but it's a constant navigation between sometimes that and sometimes that, and sometimes you're community organizer and representative, and sometimes you're a participant, and sometimes you're a speaker, and sometimes you're a moderator, and not that or the other. And thank you, great speakers, Megan Ormond, Volker Treffers, Setari Nourani, and Tsobile Chitenden. And thank you guys for being here. Those who are here, please stay and join us downstairs at the bar to ask more questions and to chat if you'd like. Those who are at home, hope you enjoyed it, and please join us next time. And we will be back on the 2nd of May with the last part of this series, Together We Design, Making Tangible Impact. Join us with Henk Ovinik. Oh, these are very difficult names. Thank you. Henk Ovinik, Grisha Zotovis, and Ekim Tan. Ah, not so bad. And thank you for watching. I think it's a wrap.